continuing with our all-out efforts here. Why? Because we know there's a battle on for our attention. A very profound battle for our attention. And the battle goes deeper than we know, actually. There's very strange bedfellows in this world who have been being promised that they can have the ascendant voice in the world, have made compromises, and they feel, well, it's worth it because they will be able to have such a strong voice in the world and be authoritative and be heard, all the media and the broadcasting, etc., that it's worth it to kind of fudge and make compromises and not quite get it. And so it's this very tricky situation in the world, to say the least. So what we're doing here is we're continuing on as fast as possible to get the true, get to the truth, get to the vision of oneness. So in light of that, I can explain what's going on here. Right in the teeth of something. So I get to share that and get to share the process, how to deal with this. And as always, the way to deal with it is to get back to the continuity problem and accept it. So instead of struggling, you stay relaxed and calm, and you say, oh, this is an expression of my continuity problem. And you honor the continuity problem because that's honoring your creativity. And your creativity is honoring God. So honor the continuity problem. Don't get angry at yourself. Say, wow, this is quite an honor to have such a severe continuity problem. That's great. Not a problem. So stay positive. Even in the face of the most maddening kind of resistance, all resistance comes from the continuity problem. The continuity problem, you'll be going along and making great headway and insight, and then suddenly something comes up, it just stops you in your tracks, and you don't know what it is, you can't figure it out, why I stop. That's the continuity fear that stopped you. It threw that up a block, it threw a stumbling block for you. So instead of staggering around and getting all upset, just quietly sit and say, oh, great. I must really be making great progress for the continuity fear to kick up such a stumbling block for me. So what, you know, it's an honor to have this continuity problem. It's honoring me, it's honoring God, no problem. And just sit quietly and take a very positive attitude towards it. For example, I was in the process of a very deep realization, a chain of realizations. I started reading some ancient spiritual treatise. I can't even say the name of it. Ashtava something, Gita or whatever. supposed to be the greatest treatise ever, you know. And I said, I don't like this. I said, I don't need this. I stopped reading it. I said, forget it. Don't struggle with it. I don't need this. And then I went into realizing that awareness doesn't need awareness. Awareness doesn't need awareness. Reality doesn't need reality. And this deepened into this incredible verge of something. I realized that this had brought me to the depths of no depth. And at that point, I kind of like froze up a little bit. I wasn't sure, like, wow, where are we now? The depth of no depth. Reality doesn't need reality. Awareness doesn't need awareness. There's no such thing as need in reality. Reality doesn't need reality. And so I said, why did I stop? What's up? And then I was listening to the baseball game. There's advertising, and they were saying the marketers are saying, this is what you've been looking for. This is what you need. This is what you need. This is what you've been. I said, what is this you that needs? I said, you need this? You need this? This is what the marketers tell you. You need this. And I say, what does you really need? What do you mean? What is this you? And what does it really need? And the answer came back and said, you needs you. You needs you. So I've just been simply allowing this, you needs you, without getting too agitated. I'm just sitting quietly with it. It's an extreme expression of the continuity fear. You needs you. What does that mean? It's like a Zen koan. Don't struggle with it. Don't try to solve it. It's simply an expression of the continuity fear based on getting to the depthless depth, the depth of no depth. Depth doesn't need depth. Light doesn't need light. And this is so profound that the continuity fear reacted to it by saying, you needs you. So I just sit quietly and honor the continuity fear, realizing where it's come from. To say that you needs you is a whim. It's a fearful reaction which turns to whim to save it, something to grab a hold of. Because I just realized there's no such thing as need. Not a, reality doesn't even need reality. And that was a little too much for me to handle, you know. I just like it expanded so much. So I got a little tight about that, like, wow. So that's fine. That's fine. So allow the block to arise in whatever form it arises. You needs you. It's a whimsicality. It doesn't have to make any sense. It doesn't make any sense. It don't need to make any sense of it. It's just an expression of saying, it's like hitting the brake. It's just hitting the brake. So you slow down a little bit. And you might say, whoa, why did you hit the brake? What caused you to hit the brake? And we'll say, well, you needs you caused me to hit the brake. I said, okay, whatever. That's fine. That's fine. You needs you. Great. Don't try to solve it. Don't try to get rid of it. Don't try to iron it out. It's a direct expression of this continuity fear. And I was able to see it consciously. I got to this point of that was just simply unfamiliar territory. I've never heard anything like this. And in all the books I've read, everything, I've never heard anything like this. Reality doesn't need reality. So this, you know, it's bound to shake up the perspective. It shook up the perspective so much that, you know, I said, hey, let me hit the brake a little bit here. So I hit the brake a little bit. A little bit, not much, just ease it. And I said, okay, hit the brake, that's fine. That's fine. See, what we're interested in here is steady, quick, steady progress. Not some frantic lunging about. So we maintain a positive, accepting, forgiving, honoring attitude. We honor hitting the brake. Why not? Of course I should. I'm going to hit the brake there. So here's the payoff. When you're kind, compassionate, forgiving, understanding, and accepting of your continuity fear, and you realize what it is, and you recognize it, then you trust yourself to go faster and get into greater depth of understanding and expansion. because you say, you know that if you need to hit the brake, you're going to hit the brake, and it's okay, and it's not going to slow you down much, because you'll say, okay, that's the continuity fear, hitting the brake a little bit, that's fine, that's great, that's, I expect it, no problem. So it actually enables you to go much quicker, maintain much greater steadiness if you do it this way. Don't get mad at yourself. If you get mad at yourself, then you're going to be afraid to get to make real progress, because the brake is going to be, you know, slammed on at some point, and the progress will seem to stop, and you'll lose it, and then you get really mad at yourself. And then the greater insight, greater place you were at, the more incensed you will get with yourself. Like, how could I lose that? That's, I'm an idiot. And you'll berate yourself and tear yourself down. And then you'll be really afraid to get into any depth at all. You know, if you do that, you'll back away and say, no, I don't want to get angry at myself again like that. And so this happens to, it's to all of us like this. And we have to learn about the continuity issue and how the role it plays. And then this dissipates the anger that you might feel at yourself, or the disappointment, or the deflation, or feeling, I can't get it. It's too much for me. No, it's simply unfamiliar territory. I mean, be honest, to say that reality doesn't need reality, to say that light doesn't need light, to say that truth doesn't need truth, awareness doesn't need awareness. These are staggering statements. So of course, the first time I'm saying these and seeing it and saying it, I'm going to be staggered by it, for sure, for sure. So you just have to say, wow, I got staggered by it. That's good, very good. And here's this "you needs you" nonsense coming up. That means I really, really, really was staggered. Great. Great. That's great. And this is where the patience and mood of repentance comes into play, which is all important. Remain sitting quietly. Do not react. Do not get angry. Do not struggle. Be humble. Recognize the limitations of the continuity fear puts upon us. Accept, be accepting of it. And just realize that it takes a little while to dissipate. Don't try to force it. Don't push the river here. Just let the river flow past you. The river of the continuity fear, let it, there's a barge floating down the river. Just let the barge float down the river. Don't say, well, where did that barge come from? Why is that barge in the way? You know, it's blocking the scenery or something. It's for the continuity fear manifested it. Manifested the "you needs you." The "you needs you" barge is blocking the beautiful landscape. And I want to see just the river. And there's the "you needs you" barge. So I say, okay, you need, great, thank you. Love it. Enjoy the "you needs you" barge. Enjoy it. Probably won't be by again. So that's an even further step. Enjoy the inanity of it. Enjoy what the continuity of fear throws up for you on the river. Say, look at that. The "you needs you" barge. Isn't that wonderful? That's great. It's going to take its own sweet time anyway. Just like this plane. Here comes a plane. Don't get angry at the plane. Now, if you're in a big hurry and under a lot of pressure, like I am now, I'm really under the most intense, under the gun so severely, then it takes a lot of will to not get all freaked out and say, wait a minute, I just about had it. I just about reached what I need to reach. And suddenly this you needs you thing popped up. I mean, how dare you? This is like, oh, you know, God hates me. He doesn't want me to succeed. You know, you can easily get into that. And then the whole thing comes tumbling down. And no, you say, that's great. Everything's perfect. Everything's fine. Perfection doesn't need perfection. Perfection doesn't need perfection. So like you needs you is like an imaginary life raft in the complete absence of an ocean. It's just, we think, well, I've got a life raft, there must be an ocean. When I saw that reality doesn't need reality, it's like, whoa, where's my life raft, you know, to show that it does need reality, you know. It's rumbling is coming from a car and several blocks over, some huge muscle car, and you can, the whole neighborhood, you can hear this deep rumbling. It's like the continuity fear. The engines are always on. And if you go too fast, it'll step on the gas there, then the whole neighborhood will just be rumbling with this, you know, massive muscle car. engine sound, so. When it roars, you let it roar, and then it'll quiet down. The sooner it quiet down, the better. So don't fight it. Don't fight it. Now, it's always disappointing when it happens, of course, because you think, hey, maybe I'm really going to succeed, you know. But we all have this spiritual ambition, like, you know what? Hey, maybe I can be enlightened. That'd be great. But it doesn't work that way. Enlightenment is way too profound not to kick up continuity fear. Way too profound. So it's we're not going to get what we really want without going through this trouble with the continuity fear, and we get shaky, we get agitated, we get nervous, we say no, we pull back, you know, we make some excuse like you needs you. I can't go there, you needs you. Don't try to explain that. That's like saying that zero needs zero. Zero needs zero. Nothing needs nothing. Need needs need. Need needs need. And you know the continuity fear is going to continue to assert this. No matter what you say, because it's afraid. But the fear does cool off. It does cool off if you don't push things too hard. You know, you don't push it too much. Just let it be. Enlightenment does need enlightenment. And don't think about, well, will I get it later today? Maybe tomorrow? When can I get going again? No, you just stay with the, in the moment. Don't try to think ahead or back. Just realize that you had a severe shock. There's no question about it. That was a severe shock. It was kind of like, whoa. I won't have any more path anymore. This is the end of the path. Reality doesn't need reality. So this is the end of the path. And I said, whoa, wait a minute. You know, you needs you. Kind of like, you know, clinging to the path. Clinging to, I need to figure this out. I need to figure need out. Need needs need. So in this instance, there's a lot of tension, a lot of discomfort. Because I can, you know, the overall dynamic is very intense. But just sit quietly. It's like that guy with the muscle car. He's just keeping it on idle. Try to keep it on idle. Don't step on it too much. Keep it on idle. You step on it too much, the sound it makes is going to scare you. I always wonder about these guys who have these muscle cars that, I mean, the whole neighborhood, you know, is being subjected to this for blocks away. You know, just a huge area, actually. Hundreds and hundreds of homes are hearing this. I'm just one guy. He's saying, hey, I got a severe continuity fear here. Hey, got a severe continuity fear. Just don't step on it too much. Yeah. So this is the discipline. This is the discipline. And it pays off. Pays off. See, I don't need to read this. I don't need to know this. I don't need to do this. I don't need to need. I don't need to need. This touches upon the very core of resolution. I don't need resolution. In other words, I don't need to need. And there, turn the muscle car off. Quiet. Sudden stillness. Just like that. Awesome. So this is the price we pay. It seems like a temporary stalemate here. But as we sit with this fear, the fear is melting away, is evaporating as we're sitting here. It's just that we're not doing much to force it to evaporate. It's just by accepting it and saying, okay, and just sitting here, we're not retreating away. So we're still very much close to the insight that we don't need insight, that I don't need to need. I don't need needs. And now the car starts up again, so the continuity fear can come back, you see. It's just the brake we have on our vehicle. We have a brake there. So when there's this massive turnaround, this incredible turnaround, you have to give it a little time to settle in, that's all. When you make progress, little time to settle in. This is why it's recommended by all the greatest teachers, is that your practice be daily. Your effort be everyday effort, and you give it time. Somehow you find a way to give your time to this situation. When you give it time, you're willing then to dive very deeply and then suffer the brakes being thrown on, continuity fear, and give it time to then kind of dissipate away. And then you've made tremendous progress. Whereas if you say, well, I'll give it 10 minutes, there's no way you can get in deep in 10 minutes and have the reaction of the continuity fear and then have it dissipate. There's no way. I say give it an hour to 2 hours. I mean, it's been over 2 hours since I had this insight, so the whole process has already taken over 2 hours. But the payoff is that the clarity that you get is vastly greater than if you tried to do it in 10 minutes. If you try to do it in just 10 minutes, it's going to be very superficial. It'll be very superficial. But if you say, I'm going to allow however long it takes, it's okay, then you can really dive deeply, get a strong continuity for your reaction, let that mellow out and settle down, let the dust settle, and then you've gone more than 10 years worth of quick efforts. People can spend their entire lives picking a little bit here, a little there. It doesn't get it done. You've seen the people with the spiritual libraries, and then they read a little bit here, and then read a little bit there. Maybe next week they read a paragraph, and 2 minutes here, 5 minutes here, and you fritter your life away that way. Many people have done that. That gives the illusion of effort, the illusion of progress. But it's still based on needs. I need to need. So they say, I definitely don't want to get rid of needs. I need to need. So stay away from looking at that. They only catch the little fish. The big ones, they don't hook the big ones. I remember long ago, when I was starting out on this very intense path, 36 years ago, somewhere along the line, I had this dream. I was fishing, and I was trying to catch fish. And what I caught was a whale, and it freaked me out. I was trying to land this fish, desperately trying to land this fish, and it turned out to be this massive whale that I had caught with a fishing pole. And I was just saying, what is going on? So my path has been very intense because I've landed this, you know, massive whale, the big fish. And you just, it takes a while to adjust to this. Like, wow, I'm really having tremendous success, more than expected. So when I get to the point, say, I don't need this teaching. I don't, awareness doesn't need awareness. Reality doesn't need reality. And I recognize this is so. You know, this is like huge success. And so I said, whoa, wait a minute. How am I going to get into bed with the spiritual PC crowd, you know, with this? There's a power movement in the world, political power movement, that is gaining power, controlling the media, the information, the message, controlling the message. And what they do is they go to people and they say, hey, if you want to have your message get out to the world, you're going to need to play ball with us, get in bed with us. And so a lot of people thinking, huh, I'd really like to have my voice heard. So, yeah, okay, well, let's make a deal. So they make a deal. They become, you know, politically PC, SPCs, spiritually politically correct. Spiritual political correctness, SPC, spiritual political correctness. And then that enables them to get their message out. But the message has been tailored in a certain way. That's always the way in this world. Whoever controls the message, the means to put the message out, they insist on having the message support their control. Absolutely, they do. And so you wonder, hey, you know, how is this going to fit in? How's the big fish going to fit in? Well, it probably won't. Which is why you things are the way they are in the world, and it's all an expression of the continuity fear. So if you go at it this way, it doesn't matter if it doesn't fit in. You're going to succeed anyway. Reality doesn't need reality to fit into reality. Awareness doesn't need awareness to fit into awareness. Now, the continuity fear will throw different roadblocks up in front of you. One might be that muscle car. Now there's an airplane that's flying around. You know, different things will come up. Somebody comes, shouts, hey, I need you. You know, it's like that. But it's okay. You just outlast them. Just sit quietly. They will go away. Now just getting used to this reality doesn't need reality to fit into reality. Yeah, I've never heard anything like that. It's got to be coming from the light. And it's like, it's just, putting this just complete wow on my thinking. So there's really nothing to think about, is there? Because thinking is, how do I fit this into this? How does this fit? And when we say we don't need to fit anything into anything, it's like, what? Here goes another plane. How did I manage to be able to sit still enough and quietly enough for such a long period of time and keep it? Is it just luck or something? No, it's not. Here's a pointer. Try in your life, if you feel you can't do this, to have an occupation where you sit quietly and you have to concentrate on what you're doing. For example, I know, see, this is something that's very advantageous to you. I know my previous life very clearly. I know I've had many quote-unquote lives here, go-arounds. But my previous life, I know my previous life very well. And I know that I spent tremendous amount of time sitting at a piano, both playing, practicing the piano, and composing. I would sit at the piano and I would compose music most of the day, every day. So I was used to sitting on a bench. I'm sitting on a bench, a piano bench. And I was used to sitting very quietly, and I was used to trying to figure something very profound out. I was trying to figure out, how can I make the greatest music possible? I'm trying to figure it out. What's going to sound just like unbelievably wonderful? What do people want to hear? What do they need to hear? And so I'd spent all my time in this kind of very subtle consideration. That's what I did for my life. So that carried over to this life. It absolutely carried over. And so at an early age, I found myself sitting, first reading books for vast periods of time. I was an avid book reader. I was able to concentrate for long periods of time, reading entire books through with great concentration at one sitting. Usually I'd read everything through one sitting, complete the whole book. I'd stay up all night if I had to complete the book. So what I did in my previous life carried over in this life. The good, the bad, and the ugly, because the bad and the ugly stuff also carried over, unfortunately. You get it all carries over. But what you do is you emphasize what's effective and just say, okay, I gotta keep doing that. And eventually the bad and the ugly, they go to the back burners. The stuff that says, you don't need to do this, that's a waste of time, Go out and have fun. Distractions, habits of distraction, and habits of trying to force creativity. I also know that I drank a tremendous amount of espresso coffee. Also smoked to use nicotine to stimulate, the concentration. The coffee enabled me to spend even longer hours late, intense long hours. Nicotine helped the concentration. So, but that also got me too tightly wound and not being able to sleep. And so in this lifetime, I had terrible problems with sleeplessness. I get too nervous and too wound up and too intense. So it was a disaster. That's why I say to people, stay away from coffee and nicotine. Stay away from all drugs. Stay away from all distractions as much as possible. Lead a clean as life as possible, because that will. And so you will not be bedeviled by, I was bedeviled by trying to do, too much, pushing myself, too strongly, using stimulants to push my creativity. And then that caught up with me in the most terrible way, this life. I was able to, you know, drive myself ferociously and just you know, ruin my nervous system. I couldn't sleep because my mind wouldn't stop. That's why I'm saying the continuity problem. Don't force it. Recognize it. See it. Bless it. Thank you. It honors God. Don't force it. I've had to learn that. Because as it is, these realizations are so profound that you do get somewhat of jitters, just naturally. And it isn't the easiest thing to sleep, actually. Because you're like, wow. You know, you get shaken up. This is really, really shocked, stunned. And if you add, like, all sorts of stimulants to your system, you're just not going to be able to sleep. You'd be reacting too much. You want to not react. You want to stay calm. So really, I learned the lesson, you know, the brutal way, absolutely brutal. Absolutely brutal. It didn't seem fair at all, really. That's why I support strict religious teachings as far as lifestyle goes, absolutely. Because I know personal experience, I know why it's important. Do not try to storm the gates of heaven. Do not try to storm the gates of heaven. And do not try to be a super creative person, you know, do not. Because what happens is you end up stimulating all your sensitivities and responses, and then from those you're able to get all sorts of ideas of how to be creative so other people can see the play of your nervous system, your emotions, your reactions, and it may delight them, and they say, oh, look at that, that is so interesting. But in the meantime, you're overstimulating yourself, and you're getting exhausted, and burned out, and that's why creative people oftentimes have horrible lives that end poorly. They get burned out. So don't get burned out. Let's say you have a hobby, playing the piano. Maybe you practice 3 hours a day or something, with very intense concentration, but not trying to be a superstar, not trying to be anything great, just as an exercise in sitting quietly, an excuse to sit quietly, as it were. Do not play with flaming ambition and emotion and passion and all this stuff. You let your play be, for instance, I call it, using piano as an example, slip key playing, like a Floyd Kramer, like a lot of the country, classic country music, just minimal kind of playing. Just try to see if you can just play this minimal style. Sing, when you sing minimally. When you dance minimally. See if you can do this, you know, minimalistic style, actually. Minimal, simple, not designed as a bravura performance. And don't get obsessed with the minimality. I know, like in the chrysanthemum shows at some places, you know, in the East, they just, you know, obsess about exactly how everything is placed, even though it's super simple. They're trying to be perfectly simple. That defeats the whole purpose of it. Defeats the whole purpose of it. Be sure to allow mistakes to, if you're a creative artist, be sure to allow mistakes to creep in. It's called the potter's thumb. There's this old Zen story about there's this Japanese potter who could throw these pots that were perfect. Perfect. And so what the potter did was he, you know, stick his thumb and put his thumb and gouge it, thumbprint or something, and wreck the perfection of it and sell them that way. That. Don't try to be perfect. Don't try to be perfect. Perfection that doesn't need to fit into perfection. Timelessness does not need to fit into timelessness. Everywhereness does not need to fit into everywhereness. Nowness does not need to fit into nowness. Presence does not need to fit into presence. Has the cognitive fear gone? No. I'm still shaking like a leaf deep inside. I can feel it. I reached the non-abyss is what happened. I reached the non-abyss. And I said, what do I do with this non-abyss? It's funny because the non-abyss seems like an abyss. If we think we need an abyss, then when you see the non-abyss, you feel like, whoa, what do I do? There's no abyss. So really the nerves are like quaking. You know, it's very shocking. Where's the abyss? Where's the abyss? I thought there's an abyss here. There's no abyss. And we might think, hey, that's great, isn't that what you want? But no, it's a continuity shock. Continuity shock. I thought there'd be an abyss, there's no abyss. I thought there'd be a need to cross an abyss, there is no abyss. Perfection doesn't need to fit into perfection. The allness of universal being doesn't need to fit into the allness of universal being. So this is putting a tremendous strain on whatever it is that is not used to this. And, you know, who talks like this? Where do you read this? You know, you're just not used to it. Oh, this is the light. This is the light saying, hey, introducing itself. The light does not need to fit into the light. I'd have to say this is the heaviest stuff I've ever come across. So don't try to monitor the reactions. Just sort of stay disinterested. Not detached, but disinterested. It's like somebody just ate a, a really hot pepper. And you know they're going through the burn and the suffering, and they're screaming, and they're acting like they're going to die. It's just terrible and everything. But you know within, 10, 15, 20 minutes, they're going to be okay. It's going to wear off. So you just hang out like that. So this kind of profound recognition, it takes a little longer than a hot pepper to wear off, that's for sure. I'm not eating any hot peppers this year. Last couple of years I've ate them, and it's like a stick of TNT going off in your mouth. But it goes away. But this is it's not like that. It's just this deep kind of feeling. It doesn't go away that quickly. Sort of like a hot pepper for the spirit. For the mind. The mind just ate a Trinidad Baruga, a scorpion. But eating those hot peppers is not good for your body. It's not good for your system. Don't do it. If you do it only like, on a dare, be careful, but don't do it excessively. It's very, very harmful for your body to eat those super hot peppers, especially green and fresh. If you roast them, roast and smoke them, so they're real dry and they've been heated up, everything, they lose a lot of their potency. But just fresh off the plant, that's a different story. I know where I could get these super hots. I know there's people growing them. But I'm telling you, if you want a real super hot, just see what I've seen today. Awareness doesn't need it to fit into awareness. Awareness doesn't need awareness. Awareness doesn't need to fit into awareness. Whew. Man, that's... Yeah, hot peppers are for amateurs. You want the real thing. Take the spiritual path. But it's interesting, the discipline is similar, where you simply need to sit quietly and not move. You see these young kids, these very reactive, on a dare, eating these hot peppers. And they just lose it. They go into panic mode. It's a terrible thing to see. They're scared out of their mind. The ones who have experience, they just sit very quietly like this and don't move. Keep their breathing steady. Don't react. And they know, they say, I'm just gonna outlast this. I'm just gonna sit here very quietly and outlast this. Don't even think about it, don't even think about it. Some of them will give detailed narration. That's their way of staying calm. Say, okay, well, the burn right now seems to be developing more in the roof of the mouth than in the back of the throat. The back of the throat seems to be not so affected at this point. It seems to be going up to my eyes and giving an intense burn throughout the whole sinus cavity. They just give us like a blow-by-blow, sort of detached narration of the whole thing. As if they were just announcing it, ringside. And that's somewhat what I do here with these videos. I'm sort of giving this narration of what's going on. It helps. It helps get through it. Absolutely. If you're just, sometimes you're just too quiet in your thoughts, you can really start to lose it. And sometimes it's better just to sort of give a nice description of what's taking place, how it is that you're managing, coping with this. And it helps, very much so. I think I came across something that the World Cup was in the United States, and Brazil was here, and I can't remember what year that was. It was 1992, maybe, 1992, something like that. 82, 84, it's in the 80s, I think. I'll have to look it up. But I actually did a documentary, a video documentary on the Brazilian team. It's very intense documentary. I tried to sell it. I tried to get someone interested. The Brazilian people were interested in it, but I never could get any. I'm not a business person, but I really chronicled the whole situation. It was an incredible situation here. All the Brazilian fans came into this area. The Brazilian team stayed here. It was a party all night long. It was just unbelievable. Situation. I actually had an old a VHS kind of video recorder back before they had digital tape. It's pre-digital, analog VHS type of recorder, and a big old one on my shoulder, and I documented the whole thing. It was a tremendous effort. I don't have the video anymore, unfortunately. But anyway, that was a long time ago, so I think I've been taping for over 20 years, making videos for over 20 years. It might have been 92. It's every 4 years, isn't it? This is 14, 10, 6, 2002, 98, 94, 90. Maybe it was 94. 94 would be 20 years. A lot of time spent talking like this to help manage getting through this. You see, the people have eaten a lot of hot peppers. They started out with mild ones and gradually built up tolerance. So they actually built up tolerance over time, so they can eat the lot. But what I'm doing doesn't harm the body. With eating hot peppers, really can take its toll on the body, for sure. But there is a way to build up tolerance. Definitely is a way to build up tolerance over time. And people may wonder, how can these insights occur and you just kind of nonchalantly say, okay, it's great. No big deal, because it's building up tolerance over such a long period of time. Every day, saying, "Okay, let me take a little stronger insight today." So this one just won't go away. That's fine. Let it stay. Probably going to be a rough night. This is a, you know, it's such a heavy one. It's not just easily going away, but it's not getting worse at all. It's just sitting there, so it's fine. In this instance, the key is don't get involved in anything particularly. Try to keep your mind fairly blank. Don't get involved in some project. Stay out of projects. Don't try to do anything really well, because then that becomes a defense, and then you get obsessed with it, thinking, if I can just do this, it'll get rid of this, you know, fear. And then you start practicing and trying to do stuff. No, just don't build any defenses against it. Just keep feeling it. Keep feeling it. Say, everything will be fine. This will lead to really breakthroughs for sure. No question it will. I'm absolutely certain of that. You see, there's no way to shake the profundity of this. There's no way to shake it. So I just have to accept it. Which means readjusting something, right? Because this is, we're dwelling in profundity, tremendous profundity here. So that's the land where I dwell in, you know, I got to readjust. Overall expectations, everything is like just rearranging, like, wow, this is we're on the 18th hole or something, you know, coming into the clubhouse here. We're going to win the tournament. You know, it's kind of like that. You're getting, you know, it's like walking up the 18th fairway and you've got a 3-shot lead, you know, and you just hit your ball close to the pin. And this is it. And you just say, oh my gosh, I'm going to win the tournament. And that's when it hits you. That's when you really tighten up. You know, an easy two-putt. You're like 8 feet away or something. Easy two-putt. And you're going to win the tournament by 3 shots. So that's when, you know, it's like, oh my gosh, I'm going to have to adjust. I'm not playing golf anymore. I'm going to be, you know, the tournament champion. I'm going to, the legacy and everything. You're the champion. Okay, wow. So it's that kind of adjustment. It's like, oh boy, wow. I just hit that one close and this is the final hole. Holy cow. So, stay very humble, very calm, very humble, low-key. Don't think about the future. Stay modest and humble, modest and humble, modest and humble. Don't really think too much about it. Just go about, you know, go about functioning. Go about your business, just like normal. That's it. That's it. All right. Days upon the path. Notes on the path. And I can't imagine what tomorrow's going to be like exactly, but, you know, it'll just be another day in the life, maybe. But meanwhile, rest of the evening just to be simple. All right. Very great. That's it.